All right. Now, last week we looked at the birth of Jesus. And you know, you had after the 70 years of exile, we have the people of Israel return. And it was a glorious thing, a tremendous thing. But it was still just a pale shadow of the glory that the prophets had predicted. You remember, you have the prophets here giving you these glimpses in pictures relevant to ancient Jews of the great glory that God was going to create and construct. And as the Jews come back from exile, which was a tremendous work of God, you have this exodus, so to speak, from Babylonian captivity, where God has them come out. But they come back, and it's still what they're experiencing is still just a pale shadow of the glory that was prophesied. They are small. They are, in terms of how they're living, you see from Haggai and Zechariah and Malachi, and you see that the moral state of the people, it doesn't comport with this image of glory. You see that they're still in a low spiritual state. They're oppressed. They're under the political rule of Persians when they come back. And this continues into the first century, where the Israelites, they are weak and poor, and they're still under the political rule now of Romans. And so it's in that environment you have the people of Israel there, just this intense longing, like Joseph of Arimathea. It says there that he's awaiting, or longing for, looking for the kingdom of God. And he's typical of many people there. There was great expectation. When is God going to intervene to heal the broken world? When is he going to intervene to take this sin-sick, broken world and set all things right? So the people are longing. How long, Lord? How long? And it's into that world that Jesus is born. As we looked last week, here we have God the Son who comes into this world. The Spirit of God puts within the Virgin Mary the God-man Jesus. And he's born in Bethlehem, the city of David. He then, after a brief time in Egypt as a small child, remember, where the family fled because of Herod, he then comes back and he grows up in Nazareth. And we have a glimpse of him at age 12, where he's down in the temple, where he was there, where he went with his family because of the Feast of Passover. We get that picture of him in the temple. And then we don't really see anything of him again until he begins his earthly ministry, which is when he's about 30. So we have from age 12 to about 30. Now, we know that he was a carpenter, just like his father Joseph. He was a carpenter, and he's up in Nazareth. And we don't hear of Joseph during Jesus' earthly ministry, after 30. So most people think that indicates that Joseph, his father, died between age 12, when he was at the temple, and sometime between that and when Jesus began his ministry around age 30. And that would have made Jesus the breadwinner of the family when that happened. But Jesus is born, he's born into the world. And he comes here, and you have John the Baptist. Now, John is, of course, Jesus' slightly older relative, typically called a cousin, but you can't be certain about that. But he's a slightly older relative, 6 months older. And John appears on the public scene before Jesus. John is a herald of the coming Messiah. He's the announcer, the trumpeter, that God's Messiah is in the world. So he's preparing the way. He is calling people to repentance, and he's calling them to join a community of anticipators. You see, they are anticipators of John's message that God's Messiah is in the world. He calls them to repent and be part of that anticipating community in light of his message that God's Messiah is on the scene. And so you have John calling Israel to repent in anticipation of his message. And Jesus comes to John. Jesus really begins his earthly ministry around age 30. He comes to John and he submits to John's baptism. It says to fulfill all righteousness. Jesus is identifying with John's message, not though as a believer in John's message, but as the object of John's message. So he's identifying with that message, and he also, there is a shift in his messianic career, because at that point he then launches into his public ministry when he's baptized. Now Jesus, he's baptized and he receives the Spirit, which is interesting. The God-man receives the Spirit when he's baptized. And then Jesus is immediately led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where he's tempted by Satan, and he proves true to God throughout that period of time. And he begins his ministry. Jesus goes out and he begins his ministry with an announcement, a proclamation of good news. He begins this ministry announcing the good news. That's what gospel means. The gospel of the kingdom of God. It's an announcement of news. It's like when you get news. Something good happens in your life. You go and say, something has occurred. Something has happened. I have news to share. And that's what this is. And this message of the kingdom of God is absolutely central to Jesus' message and ministry. If I can turn this on. This is George Ladd in his book, Theology of the New Testament. He says, modern scholarship is quite unanimous in the opinion that the kingdom of God was the central message of Jesus. He comes and he makes this announcement in his ministry, I have good news of the kingdom of God. Well, what is that good news? What is that good news? The good news is that God at long last is acting to heal the sin-sick creation. Since the fall, we've been waiting and watching God's hand and God's work. When is he going to intervene and heal the broken world? Well, people have been waiting for this. 1,500 years of the nation of Israel. Waiting. And what happens? Jesus comes on the scene and he announces the good news of the kingdom of God. And that's what he's announcing. That's what he's proclaiming. That in his life and ministry, the long-awaited kingdom of God is here. He is the kingdom bringer. You've been waiting a long time. Joseph of Arimathea, you're waiting for the kingdom of God. You and many other people. I'm bringing the kingdom. See what this slide is. Here you see a number of people, text that show this message of Christ. Matthew 4:23, Jesus went throughout Galilee teaching in the synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness among the people. Matthew 9:35, and Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom. This message, this announcement, this news that he's saying, I got something to tell everybody. At long last, through all the centuries, now is the time. Now is the time. Luke 4:43, I must preach the good news of the kingdom of God to the other towns also, because that's why I was sent. He says, Luke 8:1, Jesus went through the cities and villages proclaiming and bringing the good news of the kingdom of God. Luke 9:2, he sent the 12 out to proclaim the kingdom of God. And to heal, which I'll talk about in a minute if I can remember where it fits in. You don't know, but I left my notes home today. See, she's somebody who talks, so she's grimacing over here. She understands that. Okay. 9:6 says, leave the dead to bury their own dead, but as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God. So Jesus is, see, this great news, he has a message. And the message is that it's now. It is now in my person and ministry, the long-awaited kingdom of God is here. I'm ushering in the kingdom of God. And you see Jesus making these statements in Mark 1:15. The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. He says in Matthew 12:28, but if it is by the Spirit of God that I cast out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. The kingdom has come upon you. Luke 17:21, for behold, the kingdom of God is among you, or in your midst, as most English translations, some of the earlier translations say within you, as though it's talking about some kind of internal spiritual thing. Of course, we enter the kingdom through faith. That's how we participate and become participants of it. But I think with most English translations, he is saying that the kingdom is among you. It is in your midst, in that I, the kingdom bringer, I'm here. You see, this long-awaited kingdom is here. So Jesus makes this proclamation. I have to go to the next slide to see if I can. Okay. So he makes this proclamation and talks about this. Now, this is greeted, you can imagine, this is greeted by people. Some people are super excited about this. Of course, everybody's going to be a little, is this right? Can this possibly be? But you see all the crowds that he got. They're forcing their way into houses. I mean, he was a major buzz. People, these crowds that are coming to him, huge crowd. Why? Because he says, what you have been waiting for so long, I'm telling you, I'm bringing it. So there was, but there was also, you see, there was suspicion and there was opposition. So his ministry created both of those things. Suspicion, there was great joy, excitement, anticipation. Is this real? Is this real? Is he the one? But there are also people saying, no, he's not. He's a liar. You see, he's not bringing the kingdom of God. And one of the things, you see, it created a lot of things. And one of the things, it created some confusion because there were ideas about the kingdom of God that the Jews had created, that they had built, that Jesus had to correct. You see, they had a concept of the kingdom and the kingdom's arrival. And that concept that they had was, well, first they're looking at it in terms of some kind of military ouster, that somehow this would be a matter of military force. And more specifically, they're thinking that what this is going to be, it is going to be the ouster of the Romans from Palestine. The Romans and their supporters. So that's one idea that they had that was off. But another idea that they had was that the kingdom would come as a one-shot deal. It would come as a decisive, you have the old age, the day of the Lord, and that's it, and then the new age. The old age, the day of the Lord comes, all of that is eliminated, and then we carry on in the new age. And this is a diagram from many people that depicts that. I don't know if I got this from David Wenham, I don't remember. But you can find the concept with many theologians. This is the idea that they were laboring under. That this is how it went. You had the old age, boom, we have a one-shot deal and that's it. This decisive intervention and then we're into the new age where all of the elements of the old age are removed and eliminated. And so you can see how that would create issues for Jesus as he's here saying, I'm bringing the kingdom. The kingdom is among you. The kingdom has come. And they're looking around and they're saying, well, wait a minute. I still see all of the marks of the old age and the old order. I still see death and suffering and sin and pain. So what do you, how can you be claiming to be bringing the kingdom of God in your person and ministry when I look around and I still see all the hallmarks of the old age and the old order? So Jesus, in a number of places, in a number of his parables, in his teaching elsewhere, he corrects a number of false ideas that the Jews had constructed about the nature and the coming of the kingdom. And he tells them that the kingdom comes in two stages. There is this unobtrusive initial sowing. There is this inauguration, this introduction. Then there is a period of time, and then there is the decisive intervention when the kingdom that was inaugurated is finalized or consummated. And he tells him, you see that in the parable of the seed growing, the parable of the mustard seed, the parable of the wheat and the weeds. You see it in other teachings, you see, which we misunderstand many times because we don't understand the idea of the kingdom and what Jesus was addressing in those things. So he tells them, and that idea has been diagrammed like this. You see, there is Jesus coming, the old age of Satan with all of the stuff that we see that's twisted and bent doesn't end abruptly with the first coming. Rather, the kingdom is inaugurated or introduced, and then the two continue. We live in this overlap of ages. So when they're thinking, how can you possibly be claiming to be introducing the kingdom? Because I understand when the kingdom comes, everything that goes with the old order is gone. He says, you misunderstand. You see, I am in fact bringing the kingdom of God. It is a present reality between my two comings, but there is still an aspect of it to be consummated or finalized. At that time, there will be this decisive intervention where the old age or old order of Satan will go. And at that time, there will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. But until then, until he returns to consummate the kingdom, you and I will live in this world as kingdom participants. It is a present reality, but you and I will live in the midst of death and mourning and suffering and crying and pain. And do we not? Oh, we do. Yes, we do. And so this is the idea, you see, that here. So he announces the kingdom. That's one of the things. The first thing is he's proclaiming in his life and ministry. Now, his ministry, of course, is going to culminate. This will be for later weeks in the cross, you see. But he announces, I'm the one. I'm the kingdom bringer, what you've been waiting for all this time. And then he also teaches. So he announces and proclaims the arrival of the kingdom. But he then teaches, he corrects misunderstandings about the nature of the kingdom, but he also goes on and he teaches about what it means to live as kingdom participants. You see, when you read the parables are easily organized around the concept of the kingdom of God. You see, what is life like in between? On the journey to the consummation. What is there going to be at the consummation? And you see that Jesus, he teaches about the ethics of the kingdom. How are kingdom participants to live? How are those in this overlap of ages who come under the kingdom, who through faith in Jesus Christ come to participate in the kingdom, how are they to conduct themselves? How are they to live? And you see that Jesus says, look, the ethics of the kingdom is a call to radical righteousness. We don't like it. A lot of times don't like that. Because if you talk about that, that you can't talk about that. It's being legalistic. You read the Sermon on the Mount, just as an example, and you will see Jesus calling kingdom participants to a radical righteousness. You know, he says, look, I didn't come to, do away with, abolish the law and the prophets, but to fulfill them. And part of his fulfilling of them is his intensification of the moral requirements of the law. He intensifies those things and draws out the deepest intentions of the law. Right? So the prohibition of adultery extends to lusting. The prohibition of murder, well, that encompasses what? The anger that gives rise to murder. You see, he's not somebody who sits there and says, don't worry about ethics, don't worry about morality. He says, no, kingdom participants live a radical kind of righteousness. And don't you see, that is how the early church was so effective, because it stood in stark contrast to a world that pursued its own interests and lusts and all of that. And they're living like, who are you people? Who are you people that you will live like this and love like this and act like this and sacrifice like this? They say, well, we're kingdom participants. We are disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so he calls us to a radical righteousness. And you see that the apostles all over, they got that message. They understood that. You know, it's all over the New Testament. But here's, I didn't remember that this slide was here, but here, when I was talking about the now and the not yet, let me go back to that. But here you see these texts that show that the kingdom is a present reality between the first and second coming of Christ. So you can see that. It is something that is now. There is a sense in which the kingdom is present now. But there's also a sense in which it's a future hope. And you have these texts here that you can look at, or you, when I ultimately post them, or you can email me and I'll send it to you. But you see, so it is part of the now. There is a sense in which the kingdom is present. It's not in the consummated sense, but it's a present reality. But there's also a sense in which it's a present, a future hope. And so you see this very idea of the now and the not yet. It characterizes other kingdom-related concepts. Let's see if that's the next slide. Okay, I showed this slide, a month or two ago when I was preaching on Sunday night. So those of you who are there, just grin and bear it. But here you see it's not only is the kingdom present, but also a future hope, something that is to be inherited. Okay, inherited, it's not yet my possession. But it is. There's a sense in which it's now. There's a sense yet in which it's a future hope or expectation. You see that same idea of the now and the not yet with these other kingdom-related concepts. Eternal life. There's a sense in which it's yours now. But there's a sense in which it's still to come. You see, end of the ages, there's a sense in which it's now. There's a sense in which it's still to come. Redemption. There's a sense that's yours now. There's a sense in which it's still to come. Salvation, now. Salvation is a present possession. There is a sense in which that's true, but there is a sense in which salvation is what? Still to come. You have adoption, now. You're already adopted. There's a sense of that, but there's a sense at the resurrection when there's a future adoption. So it is both now and not yet. Now in one sense, not yet in a fuller, more complete sense. You see death's defeat, now, still to come. New creation, now, still to come. So this is something that characterizes all of these kingdom-related concepts. And so you have that where, you know, and I was off teaching. All right, Jesus now in speaking of it, so he teaches about the kingdom. He announces it. He teaches about the kingdom, setting straight some of these misunderstandings. And then he also teaches about the ethics of the kingdom. That's why I'm saying he calls people to a radical righteousness. He calls people to live not because how we live earns us anything. It is something that is motivated by the grace of God. Who should live more righteous lives than people who have been rescued and redeemed at such a great cost? Should we not be the most righteous, holy living people and not apologize for it? We're almost embarrassed to live righteously because I don't want anybody to think I'm a holy Joe. I'm, you know, self-righteous. So I don't want to do. Why? We are to live. We are to be honest about ourselves. It doesn't take much introspection to see that I am a sinful person, selfish, prideful, all of those things. So it just takes a little introspection to keep you calm down. Right? But the idea, look, we're going to live in a way and call each other to live in a way that honors God. Why? Because he's rescued us and he calls us to live that way. You see Jesus in Matthew 7:21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Well, it sounds like moral living, righteous living, holy living is not some optional extra that can be jettisoned by an appeal to grace. I don't get to say, well, I'm saved by grace, so who cares? God doesn't expect me by the power of the Spirit to live in a way that glorifies him. Oh, he does. You see, he does. And as I say, the apostles understood this well. You see, Paul, many places, could have pulled out many texts But in Romans chapter 8, verses 12 to 13, it says, "Now therefore, brothers, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you're going to die. Brothers, brothers, you're going to die. Brothers, you're going to die. If you live according to the flesh," what does that mean? If you reject God's call on your life and do not, in appreciation and submission to Him and in faith and trust in Him, live in a way that honors Him. If your faith is not genuine that way, He says you're going to die. But if by the Spirit you're putting to death. Okay, wait a minute. The Spirit, it's by the Spirit, but do you have a role to play? Indeed. If by the Spirit you are putting to death the practices of the body, you'll live. So what does that mean? He's talking about Christian sanctification. As a person who's in Christ, you and I are being transformed by the Spirit as we yield to the Spirit's transforming work in our lives to make us over and over into the image of Jesus. Okay, so that's what he's talking about. That is inevitable in the life of a Christian who is submitted and surrendered to the Lord Jesus. The Spirit will transform you. Now, because it is a matter of God's grace, look, you understand this now and the not yet. So we will, that is our target. That is our goal. Being like Christ is our goal. That is what we strive for. Okay? But the fact of the matter is that in this overlap, we are not yet and will not be what we will one day be in the consummation. That means that we are going to fail. But do we then say, well, look, I'm not going to be perfect in this life. I'm not going to be completely like Jesus in this life. So who cares? I won't even strive for that goal. I'll just blow it off and live the way I want to and be thankful for grace. Well, see, when you do that, you're basically rejecting God's call. You see, you're rejecting His call. And so that's no way to live, and you can't do that. You and I live. So what I was going to say is that because we understand that it is not our performance, our goodness that earns us anything, and we understand that we are in fact going to fail in this overlap of ages, but that's not a source of anxiety for us because we understand that it is not our performance that earns us life either in the intermediate state or in the eternal kingdom, consummated kingdom. It is the gift of grace of God. So we continue to pursue Christ-likeness seriously, to allow the Spirit to transform us seriously. We don't excuse, justify sin. We don't do any of that. When we sin, we repent, we confess it, we're sorry, and we get up, dust ourselves off, and start the journey again. Continue on the journey. Okay, that's important. Peter says in 1 Peter 1:14, 16. "As obedient children, do not conform to the former passions when in your ignorance, but like the Holy One who called you, you also be holy in all your conduct, for it is written, 'Be holy because,'" no hyphen, "'I am holy.'" Well, you're to be holy. Why? Because I'm holy. I'm holy and I have rescued you. And I have redeemed you at such a tremendous cost. I have called you out of the world. I've brought you into the kingdom. You see? And I've given you life and everything. And I am God, and I call you to honor me by the way you live in this life. And so it's serious. It's very serious. So you have here this idea, you have the ethics of the kingdom that Jesus talks about. But also he models. Jesus not only, he comes and he makes an announcement that the kingdom is here. He comes and he teaches regarding the nature of the kingdom and the ethics of the kingdom. And what does it mean to be kingdom participants in this overlap of ages? And he teaches about that in his parables and elsewhere. He does those things. But he also demonstrates the nature of the kingdom. You see, he said that's what his miracles are. They're not just tricks, you know. They're part of a larger flow of theology. And what is he doing? He's saying the kingdom that I announce, that I am bringing, I am pulling the future into the present. I am reaching forward and I am bringing into this reality the eternal kingdom of God. It'll be consummated when I return, where all that's contrary to the eternal purposes and vision of God will be stripped out. But for now, we live in this overlap, and I have pulled into the now. So he's demonstrating, well, what is this kingdom like? Well, what are you expecting? I'm expecting this place, with this state of God's fullest assertion of his authority, where all things will be brought into harmony with his ultimate vision and purpose. I'm expecting that there's going to be no death, no mourning, no crying, no pain. And that's what Jesus is doing with these miracles and healings. You see, he's exhibiting the nature of the kingdom in part. It is not the consummation yet, so everybody's raised from the dead, so everybody is healed. It's not that, but it is an exhibition of the nature of the kingdom. Let me read to you what John Piper said. He says, the answer to why Jesus did not raise all the dead is that, contrary to the Jewish expectation, the first coming of the Messiah was not the consummation and full redemption of this fallen age. The first coming was rather to purchase that consummation, illustrate its character, and bring a foretaste of it to his people. Therefore, Jesus raised some of the dead to illustrate that he has that power and one day will come again and exercise it for all his people. And he healed the sick to illustrate that in his final kingdom, the consummated kingdom, that is how it will be. There will be no more crying or pain anymore. You see, so that's the context of what he's doing in these miracles. When he raises the dead people, when he works this tremendous power, that's what he's doing. He's exhibiting this, because we ask, like, oh, well, why didn't Jesus come and just heal everybody? Because it's not the time. That will happen at the consummation of the kingdom, when death will be no more. You see, when was death introduced? It was introduced with sin at the fall. You see that? Do you see the big picture? We're following the story, right? The story, the big picture of the Bible. Well, what happens? God creates this beautiful, very good creation. What happens? Sin corrupts it. Sin invades. There is this fall. Creation itself is implicated in the sin. Mankind falls. You see sin multiplying, multiplying. We have the flood. You go on. What is God going to do? He's going to create a nation. And from that nation, he is going to heal this broken creation. Well, see, Jesus comes through that nation. Jesus comes through that nation. And it's just important. You know, now Jesus, you know, when Jesus is here talking about the kingdom, you understand that part of the anticipation of it was that Daniel, some 600 years earlier, Daniel chapter 2, he had said, God revealed to Daniel, my eternal kingdom is going to come in the Roman Empire. Now, he didn't say those words, but he said it was going to be the fourth empire that was symbolized in the vision in Daniel 2 that was given, the dream of Nebuchadnezzar, the image that Nebuchadnezzar saw. It would be the fourth kingdom. And so here is Jesus during the days of the Roman Empire saying, the kingdom is here. The kingdom has I'm bringing the kingdom. And you see that, and he introduces that. Now, you also see this same idea, by the way, of what Piper's talking about, of he announces, he teaches, and he demonstrates the nature of the kingdom. You see it with his miracles and his raising of people, but you also see that in his exorcisms. You see, when Jesus expels demons, what are the people saying about him? They're saying, well, he does that by the power of the chief demon, Beelzebul. That's how he's doing it. And Jesus sets them straight. And he says, no, I'm exactly the opposite of somebody who's working in cahoots with Satan. He says, because nobody can rob a strong man's house unless he first binds up the strong man. You see, so he says that what I'm doing is the exact opposite of what you're accusing me. I am exhibiting kingdom power over Satan, in that I am rescuing from his clutches those he had possessed. You see, so he tells him that. And then he ties that work, by the way, he ties that exorcising work specifically to his bringing the kingdom of God. If I have this here, he says, no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man. Then indeed he may plunder his house. So he says, what you're saying about me is crazy. Because Satan's got control of the person. I'm taking the person back. Now, how do you think I'm doing that? I'm tying that guy up. He's got nothing on me. I'm exerting this kingdom power that is going to, at the consummation, be everywhere. Fully asserted. Fully exerted. So he says that. But then he says in Matthew 12:28, as he specifically ties his exercising work to his bringing the kingdom, he says, but if it's by the Spirit of God that I cast out demons, you're saying it's by the spirit of the chief demon Beelzebub. I'm telling you, you're wrong. I'm doing anything but that. And he says, if it's by the power, if it's by the Spirit of God, which it is, that I cast out demons, well, then I got news for you. The kingdom of God has come upon you. You see, he says, I want you to see that my exorcising work, just like my miracles, the raising of the dead, my exorcising of demons is part of the demonstration of the nature and character of the kingdom, which at the consummation, there will be no demons. They will be banished to the away place. The away place, you see, that will not be part of what you and I share in the kingdom. They're going to be over here in an eternal bummer. Okay? Off the grid, and we're here in this new heavens, new earth, glorified reality. But he says, see, he ties that to them. So you have Jesus announces this good news of what he's doing. He teaches and corrects misunderstandings about the nature of the kingdom. He teaches about the ethics of the kingdom. How are we as kingdom participants to live? He talks about that. Then he demonstrates the nature of the kingdom through his mighty works. He demonstrates that. And he also trains the apostles. Right? Jesus called 12 disciples, called apostles. And what is he doing? He calls them to be particularly close to him, that he might teach them and really work with them so that when he's ascended, they are going to be a nucleus that is going to teach and spread and instill his teaching into the body of Christ, into the church. So what'd they do? They did that. Right? You look at the church. What happens to the church? It begins with this, you know, little group of people who are all afraid, and I'm going to get ahead of the story here. And then after the resurrection, what happens? Well, these guys become people you can't shut up. In essence, they say, what are you going to do to me? I have had a, you know, complete turnaround. I know to the bottom of my soul that Jesus Christ is the Messiah and that the kingdom of God has come and that I am just waiting for the consummation. And so what can you do to me? You see, what I have seen and what I know is larger than any threat you can throw against me. Well, you're going to lose your job. You're going to lose this. Hey, I don't care. I don't want to lose my job. Don't want to lose my life. But I've seen something bigger. And so you have these people. And so out of this group, the church simply explodes. And then weeks down the road, we're going to talk about the church. But that's what Jesus did. He trained the apostles, the disciples. Of course, he knew who Judas was. And you have, he's replaced. And then we also have Paul come in. But these are the people who wind up, what, writing? You know, many of the documents, of course, all inspired, but the Spirit of God is what? Instilling their teaching, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. So what happens? He trains them up. They see him through all of the headaches, and you look at it and you say, how can they be that way? But they ultimately got it. You see, they ultimately got it when they saw the Lord Jesus again after he'd been crucified. They said, whoa. You see, okay, this is the real deal. Because, you know, it wasn't anything like, well, did he die? None of that. They knew, dead man, there he is. You see, there he is. And so that just changes everything, doesn't it? I mean, that changes everything. And see, that's probably one of the things I like focusing on. And, it was important to me, and I think it's important for people, is the resurrection of Jesus. And we'll get to that. Of course, I've done I don't know how many weeks on it, so this will have 40-some minutes. So we'll do what we can on resurrection. But it's just really important, see, to see that that's a fact. You see, you can go back and you can determine that fact as well historically as anything else. You mean you can prove it signed? No, no. But, you know, it's like you go back and you try to say, well, did Washington live? Did Napoleon live? And just keep going back and everybody, you know, did Nero live? Well, how do you know that? Well, I'm certain he lived. Why? Because I see writings about him. Okay. All right, so it's a historical investigation that doesn't depend on the inspiration of Scripture, but you can go back and you can see that. So he trains these apostles, he announces, he teaches, he demonstrates, and he trains. And then his ultimate ministry, I heard that bell, his ultimate work of ministry, what, is at the cross. See, because his bringing the kingdom in is really a complex of events that involves his teaching, his working of miracles, his explaining these things, but ultimately, his crucifixion, resurrection, and ascension. Then with that block, you see, the kingdom has been inaugurated, and you and I live in that overlap of ages. Okay, I hope I never have to do this again without my notes, but there you have it. Thank you.